is this about sin? Why has it disappeared, the word?
They say the same thing about God. I mean, you're not allowed to teach that kind of stuff in school. I mean, it's being unlearned. And we become a nation that's being intolerant. We need to be able to let people express themselves and be who they are and be free.
When people talk about, we just need to be more accepting, that's right. Your opinion. That's good for you, but that's not good for me. What are they saying?
Tolerance.
That tolerance is what?
It's good. It's okay if I what I
that tolerance
is the ultimate
is the value of how we determine what is right and wrong. They still have right and wrong, but if you don't tolerate them, you're wrong.
Right.
That's the standard. What's wrong with tolerance?
It's the lowest common denominator.
No, it's even lower.
There's no vision there. There's no vision with tolerance. No company will put out a product based on tolerance.
That's true.
The same with the church. We're supposed to make disciples, but if we just put out whatever kind of disciple, the church will never go anywhere. Because we're just supposed to accept everything and be tolerant. Because if I step into your life and say, hey, sister, I just want to share with you. I want you to pray about it. You know, I might not be seeing it right, but you know, think about this attitude that I see popping up every once in a while. And all of a sudden, you talk to people like that, rawr, I'll never go back there again. Why does that happen? If I really didn't care about you, I would never address you. But in relationships, I have to have permission to speak into your life. You're going to have to trust me. But we have to talk things out. It's just not message delivery like I am the only one that can see. I'm here and you're there. But how come we can't, can we talk to each other like this? What gets in the way?
Ego.
Sin! There you go. That's what gets in the way. And what is sin?
Separation.
That's the result of sin is separation. But what is sin?
Anything against the word of God.
Technically, and I think many of us heard this, it means missing the mark or the design of God. How many know that when you sin, it's against God? You're saying, God, I don't want to follow you. That's what sin is. It's not against people. That's second. You're putting a wedge between you and God. You're saying, God, I want to follow you. I want to do what I want to do. That's what it's saying. How many feel that when you're tempted? Well, I'm going to reject God now. Is that what you're thinking?
No.
But that's what it is. But that's what it is. It's not about that other thing. It's about your relationship with God. This is what Menninger says. He argues that instead of the historic concept of sin, we now speak of crime and symptoms. He says, whenever we look at sin as either crime or symptoms, we are missing the essence of right and wrong and personal choice. Once we depersonalize it and remove it from ourselves, we don't have choice anymore. God is taken out of the picture because biblically sin and is committed between a person and God or people and God. Crime, by definition, is malfeasance between two or more human beings. It's between people. That's crime. We don't look at sin. Or vinegar ads, we substitute sin and turn it into symptoms like, my problem is I just have behavioral tendencies. That's my issue. I have behavioral tendencies. Oh, I have personal defects. I don't have sin. I have personal defects. It's heredity. That's just the way I am. You just got to have to deal with me. Or it's the environment. Or my early life experiences, whatever those things are. That's my problem. When sin is swept under the rug, we fully blame these outside factors for our actions. What do you think? What if we would just stop doing that? What if we make a statement today and say, I'm going to own up. I'm going to get straight. I'm going to get right. I'm going to be purely honest. No more shifting the blame. The common denominator in all the problems in your life is you. Let's just think about it, right? Ezekiel 18 says, do you need to ask, so why does the child not share the guilt of the parent? Isn't it plain? It's because the child did what is fair and right. Since the child was careful to do what is lawful and right, the child will live truly and well. The soul that sins is the soul that dies. Nobody's going to be responsible for your sin. And you're not going to be responsible for anybody else's sin or choices, right? The soul that sins will die. As a child does not share the guilt of the parent, nor the parent the guilt of the child. If you live upright and well, you get the credit. If you live a wicked life, your guilt is charged. Clean! No more blaming. What if from this point on we wouldn't blame anymore? No blaming, no excuses. What do you think? Can we do it? No more blaming, no more excuses. Period. We own up. Yes?
I just have a quick question. If you want to set up, I don't want to share the ask, right?
Absolutely. I may not know all the answers.
Okay, this is saying that the child does not share the guilt of the parent. But doesn't it say what you reap, what it is? So sometimes it falls on your generation or your children or whatever that you've done. It's like all the centers. I'm just trying to separate the two. What's the difference?
We still have choices.
And so if the child chooses to do the right thing, then they won't suffer from what the parent.
Absolutely.
Is.
Absolutely.
But if they don't, then they can reap.
Now, it does pave a way. I will say that. I think we all understand this. The chances are higher that you may abuse alcohol or food or whatever if that happened in your home. I think we all understand that. If that happened in your home, in the home of your parents' home, and it's gone down the generations, that's the environment. Now, does the environment... Now, either we're going to listen to our environment or we're going to listen to God. We still have choices. Yes, could you want to say something?
But there are generational curses. There are inherited things. I mean, even if a parent has abandonment issues from something in their childhood, their child can be born with that genetically embedded. And they don't know why. They're freaking out over something. So... yeah, but it also says that, you know, says to the third or fourth generation that can go on, but it also says that things can be carried from a godly person to thousands of generations on. So the good, even more so, but we usually hear it on the negative end. A lot of it is when we're children, we don't have the wherewithal to process it and to deal with it. That's why Paul says, when I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, and I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. So there came a point where a person recognizes, and then they have a choice.
Yes.
Are they going to remain a victim, or are they going to use the power that they have in Jesus Christ? And the resources around them, because sometimes we need help from others.
Larry Crabb had a thought in a book that I read many years ago, and I remember underlining. He says that your sin has a greater impact on your life than your woundedness. Your sinfulness has a greater impact on your life than any wounds that you have. If we don't believe that, then we're not responsible. Then we're victims. Now, I'm not going to say our wounds and the generational curses can't have an impact on our life, but our sinfulness has a greater impact on our life than any of the exterior. Because true salvation is an interior job. By Almighty God changing our hearts.
Can I give them an example?
Stand up.
I was sexually abused as a child. And as an adult, I saw a skit that was a trigger for me because I didn't even remember the stuff. But then I had to work through forgiveness. My sinfulness, the unforgiveness, was impacting me more than the woundedness. Because at that point, it wasn't still happening. But, you know, it was a process to deal with it and to work it through. So that would be an example.
So like if, for people that are like me, like, you know, you've been abandoned and rejected, as long as you don't use that as an excuse to continue to sin,
right.
And you say, you know what, Lord, I'm going to use this as something to help others with, then you're not a victim anymore. You stop that, right? My understanding.
Right. And say, God, show me my choices. Because once we, I think a trick that the enemy does, he says, you don't have any more choices. Once we think we have no more choices, the enemy's got us. We always have a choice. And you know what the first choice that normally goes, that we give up, is our attitude. You can tell someone's going the wrong way, even though their behavior's not going the wrong way, if their attitude's going the wrong way. And your attitude is your state of mind and your state of heart. Check your attitude, because your life behaviors are going to follow. Many understand this. One of the first things that goes is your attitude. Because once we start getting ungrateful, bitter, resentful, good question.
And by the way, you know, we think it's evil people that are demonized. More often than not, it's people who've been traumatized and victimized that are demonized. Because the demons build on lies. And that the victim believes all kinds of lies.
Here is David in Psalm 51, after this series of choices that he made, ending with Bathsheba and the child dying and Nathan confronting him about the sin that he had, says, "You're the man." This is a snippet. He says, "God, you're the one I've violated." We will start to understand our choices when we realize that when we're not choosing God's way, we're violating God. If we would look at sin as a violation of God, we're violating. If someone gets violated, what happens to them? In the word violated is the word violence. It's vile. It's evil. Evil has been done to somebody if they're violated, right? When we sin, we're violating God. Whew. What if we would start thinking like that? Man, I don't want to go there. I'm abusing. You're the one I violated. He violated Bathsheba. He violated his power by having her husband killed. He violated all sorts of other people. But it's God, I violated you. And you've seen it all, even the full extent of my evil.
Yeah.
Whoa. You have all the facts before you. Whatever you decide about me is fair. Have you been this way with God? Whatever you want. Been out of step with you for a long time. In the wrong sense, before I was born. That's what sin is. Isn't that what sin is? We are not sinners because we sin. We sin because we're sinners. You understand that? We are not sinners because we violate God. How many know that you have violence in your own heart? We have a sin nature in us. That's egotistical. That's about me. That's all those things that we've talked about in that front that's going to happen in the end. That's our problem. And we need born anew. We need a brand new life. Not just a new coat of paint on the fence. The whole fence needs torn down. I like this. What you're after is truth from the inside out. We don't need to put on outside things and clean up the outside. What you desire is truth. In the inmost place, enter me then and conceive a new true life. That's when we change. When God comes into the inside. Following Jesus, it's an inside job. Story in the gospel, and then just to close, we're going to continue this series. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus answered, no one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. You shall not defraud. honor your father and mother. Teacher, he declared, all these I have kept since I was a boy. Jesus looked at him and loved him. One thing you lack. Go sell everything you have and give to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had grown up. There's different things that you can pull out of this. I submit. His whole focus was off. He just wants to add Jesus to his life. He just wants to add Jesus to his life. And not go to hell. Isn't that what he says? What must I do to inherit eternal life? No. His whole focus is off. I want a new life. We can't change until we're willing to give up the life we have. And then he began, how do you like this? He gets into this little thing there. Good teacher. He didn't understand who Jesus was. He didn't call him Lord. So why do you call me good? Only God's good. Is God Lord of our lives? There's a focus. Lord. And then he gets said, no one's good except God. You know the commandments. You should murder, adultery, steal. And notice all these commandments have to do with what? Our relationship with people this way. But then Jesus went to a whole other place. He says, teacher, I've kept all these. He says, one thing you lack is the relationship this way. You're trying this way. It's the relationship this way. God has a great resume as a change agent. How many know that? If you tried changing and you haven't changed, guess what? What would you say? There's something wrong this way. That's it. It's about this relationship. It's not about living this way. Our eyes are about living this way. We can't live this way until this is firm. It's about this relationship. Sin is about us and God. That's so, it's time to get honest with yourself, God, and others. Do I really want to change and change God's way? That's really the question. Do I really want to change and change God's way? I can already hear some people let me know what that means. No, you've missed it already. It's about giving up everything and changing and doing it God's way. It's not about debating strategies with God. It's about a brand new way. How many want to open their heart? Say, God, I want to see myself as I really am. And I want to see you. We don't need a new vision for life. We don't need a new strategy for life. We need a new vision of who God is and who we are. I mean, I've worked through this. To only the point, that's the right thing. But I would go back here. Are you ready to get honest with yourself, God, and others? If not, I want you to stand and say, it's time. It's time. I want to get honest with myself, God, and others. Let's raise our hands. Lord, my life is before you. Like David, Lord, I don't always see it, but Lord, it help us to see it and to feel it and to know it, that we're violating you. And for those of us that stood, and those of us who hadn't, are not standing, Lord, you have us here. Help us, give us a tender heart, an honest heart, an open heart. We give you permission to come in and change us from the inside out. Let us see our lives, our choices, what we do, today, Lord, we are saying we're going to stop blaming and stop making excuses. And Lord, we give you permission God, to tell us when we're off the path.